Is it visible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we let me quickly summarize the generative process in latent directory allocation, how a document is generated. We have two matrices. One is a topic proportion matrix. Topic proportion matrix, basically a topic versus document matrix. Each row of the matrix is a document. I have four documents, and each column is a topic. I have four topics also. And the values of this matrix represent, say, for example, if we take the first row, it represents the probability that this document contains this topic. Okay, so topic one is not present in this document, topic two is not present in this document, topic three is very dominant in this document. Similarly, topic four is also present, but maybe secondary. So this row is a vector. Let us have these values. Let's say I have k topics. D words in my dictionary and n documents in my corpus. Okay, so this will be a n cross k matrix, and each row of the matrix is a vector for the corresponding document. And what this this vector is a k-dimensional vector representing the distribution or proportion of topics in doc 1. We can also note that every row will sum to 1. The topics proportion, we set it in such a way that they sum to 1. So we can think of this k-dimensional vector corresponding to topic 1 as a distribution, as a multinomial distribution. So again, as if you can think of it as a k-faceted dice, and these probabilities are nothing that probability of outcome of each of the phase, so as many phases as many topics. It's a probability of outcome. So what we do is first we kind of throw a generate a random number between 0 to 1, and depending on the outcome of the random number, so it's very easy to see. So it's 0.7, 0.3. So I have 0.7 here and 0.3 here. I generate a random number. So this is T3. And this is T4. I generate a random number between 0 and 1. If it turns out to be in this interval, I generate the topic T3, otherwise T4. So I can, every step of the generative process, for every document, I generate a topic. And once that topic is generated, what I do is that I have, I'm coming to that. Let me discuss that. So I have another matrix, which, you know, a topic is nothing but a collection of words. A topic is nothing but a combination of words. So this is a topic word matrix. This is the second matrix that is important. This is the topic word matrix. So this will be, if there are k topics and d words, this will be k cross d. So what this matrix tells is that, for example, topic 1, so every topic, if there are d words, every topic is represented by the contribution of each of these d words to this particular topic as a probability. So what here it says is that topic 1 is a combination of mostly the word 3 and also to some extent what 2 and what 4. Also to some extent what 2 and what 4. So these are, you can again think of this as probabilities. So if we look at topic 1, with 0.8 probability there is what 3, and with 0.1 probability there is what 2, and with 0.1 probability there is what 4. So this vector again is a characterization of a topic. It is a d-dimensional vector, and the components of this vector are the contribution of the each of these d words to this topic. Note that here also this rho should add up to 1, and this vector again as a multinomial distribution, but now I have a capital D facet dice where each face represents a word, and these are probabilities of a particular face being the outcome. So again here, if you generate a random number, I'll get one particular word proportional to these probabilities. So the generative process is as follows. First, what I'll do, so suppose I want to generate doc 1. I will generate a random number, and depending on the outcome of this random number, whether it is in the interval 0 to 0.7 or 0.7 to 1, I'll pick up a topic. Let's say topic 3 is picked up by this random number. So this is random number 1, trial 1. Once this topic is picked up, what I do is that I now consult the second matrix. I go to the T3 row of the second matrix. I go to the T3 row of the second matrix. So now T3 row has again a vector like this, again a multinomial like this. I will now use this multinomial. What I will do with this multinomial is, I will again randomly generate a number between 0 and 1. So again, I have something like this, so 0.8 and 0.2. 0.8 is W3 and 0.2 is W2. I'll generate a random number. If it is in the interval 0 to 0.8, I pick up W3. Otherwise, I pick up W2. Let's say I have picked up W3. Let's say this random number produced W3. So now this is the second trial. So I have two trials to throw up the dices to generate a word. So now I have picked up W3. W3 is a word. This word I put in this bag of word, which is my doc 1. Which is my doc 1. I put in this bag of word. And this process of these two trials and then generating a word and putting it here, these two trials, if the word has a length L, I'll repeat these two trials L times. So this way, I'll get L words inside a document. L word. How do you decide the value of L? That will come up later. Let's initially assume that we know that every document in my collection consists of exactly L words. And I repeat this L number of times. Maybe some words will appear multiple number of times, and hence I get a bag of words. Note that in our document model is a bag of word model. That means it's just a collection of words, maybe with duplicities. But the sequence of words in the document are not being considered. We throw that away, that information. That is not being considered. So this way I generate a document. Now the question is that how do I get these matrices? Because what we have understood till so far is that once we get these matrices, we can probabilistically generate this word by this random number generation. You can probabilistically generate this document. But how do we get these matrices in the first place? Okay, these matrices actually will be obtained from a training data. From a training data, in the sense that I will be given a set of documents with their topics labeled, And also, I will be given a set of topics with their word component. So that I'll not be given. What I'll actually be given is that a set of documents and the number of topics in that document. From that, we'll construct these two matrices from the data given to us. But these values that we populate this matrix with, of course, we'll get it from the data, but there will be some restrictions on what type of values you can fill up these matrices with. First of all, note that we so far decided that you can sort of put any value between 0 to 1 to populate this matrix. Only concern is that each row should sum to 1, so that each row is a valid distribution. Each row should sum to 1. But that again also, lot of possibilities are there. But we are not considering all such values. We put some restriction. So not only we want each row to be a distribution, a multinomial distribution, we want each row to be a particular type of multinomial distribution. That multinomial distribution should follow some property. What is the property? The property is the sparsity property. That means that if we look at a document and if we look at the proportion, topic proportion vector of that document, we want a document to reflect at most one or two topics. It should not talk, because naturally, in physical world, a document talks up about only one or two topics. It does not talk up about all topics in the world. It talks about, so only few of these entries will be non-zero, and most of the entries, I have only taken four topics here. In general, there may be 100 topics, 1000 topics. Most of the entries will be zero. Only few entries will be non-zero. So this sparsity we require for every row. Similarly, if we look at the topic word matrix, we say that every topic will consist of a small set of words. Will basically is a contribution comes from a small set of words. And most of the words do not belong to most of the topics. So every row of this topic word vector, definitely it is a multinomial distribution, but it has to be a sparse multinomial distribution. Most of the entries are zero. So these two restrictions we want while filling up these two matrices with values that we estimate from the data. So these are two kind of constraints or restrictions that we want. And you know so now let us look at the constraints a little more geometrically. So what these constraints means is that, so let us look at this topic document vector. So these four values, or let's say there are three topics, it will be easier for me to explain. As we have explained that I can consider this vector as a point lying inside a simplex. So this will be, I cannot draw a fourth simplex. Let's assume it looks like this is actually a three simplex, but here it is a four simplex, but I'm explaining with a three simplex. So every point, every row of this matrix is a point lying inside this simplex. Okay, inside this simplex. But so that's a property of a multinomial. If you take the probability values of different faces of a multinomial, they'll also always lie in the simplex. This comes from the fact that they add up to one. But all points inside the simplex are not sparse multinomials. Okay, sparse multinomials means most of the, so this is T1, this is T2, and this is T3. And you know this is the value of this 0.4 0.7, 0.3, 0.0, and so on. So what it means to be a sparse is that if we pick up every row and place it inside the simplex, that point would lie either near the corner or near the edge. Either near the corner or near the edge, it will lie. Because if it lies in a corner, it means only topic T1 is present, no other topic is present in that document. If it lies in this edge, it means only topic T1 and T3 is present in this document, other T2 is not present in this document. So this is what we want. We want it to be sparse. So if I plot all these points, so this is one point, this is for doc 2 is another point, doc 3 is another point. If we plot them inside this simplex, they will be dense near the corners and the edges. They will be near the corner and the edges. So if we plot their probability densities across the simplex, they will maybe look something like this. So this is my simplex, and there are most of the points are in this T1. Here it is T3, T4. So let's write this T3, T4 region. At least doc 1 is in this T3. Maybe I've not written it like this, but it is in this T3, T4 simplex. T3, T4 edge of the simplex. Right. So, and we have already seen that this property, that in the simplex that they are in the edges, these are nothing but a Dirichlet distribution. These are nothing but, you see, there is a high density region near the corners and the edges. So sparse polynomials are kind of favored by this. So are kind of favored by this. So what I earlier said, that I want to put a constraint that each of these rows should be sparse. This Dirichlet distribution, what it helps me to do, it helps me to not put a hard constraint that they should be sparse, but to kind of put a soft constraint. And this distribution is kind of a soft constraint in the sense that it will favor, if we randomly pick up a multinomial from this Dirichlet, it will favor a multinomial which is sparse. Maybe it will favor this kind of vectors. Because see, every time you sample from this Dirichlet, you will get a T1, T2, T1, T3, T4 vector. You will get one such row vector. And this Dirichlet will favor a row vector around the corner or near the edges. It will favor such a row vector. All right. So basically, using a Dirichlet distribution, I can give a probabilistic constraint, probabilistic sparsity constraint on the topic proportion vectors. So using the data, you can generate any value in this matrix. But I kind of impose a Dirichlet. What the Dirichlet says is that you cannot do anything from the data. Whatever you estimate from the data has to satisfy a probabilistic constraint of sparsity, which I am specifying by the Dirichlet distribution. Okay, and you know from the standard Bayesian inference that we have been talking so far, that any probability, posterior probability, has two parts, a likelihood part, which comes from the data, and a prior part, which comes from knowledge. So here, this Dirichlet kind of acts as a prior. It gives us the knowledge that this is sparse. So, this knowledge is not exactly a knowledge. You can rather think of it as a constraint. The prior actually gives you a constraint. The prior gives a broad restriction that this is what your probability should be. It gives a broad restriction, which of course comes from knowledge or sparsity in this case. So this prior gives this constraint, a broad constraint, a general criteria that should be satisfied. But among these Dirichlet distributions, of course, whatever is most suitable according to the given corpus, labeled corpus given to us, those values will be given. Okay, so all these samples I draw from here, they will populate each of these rows, and thus I will get this matrix. Matrix will have two criteria. One is it has to agree with the data. Second is it has to satisfy this prior constant given by the Dirichlet distribution. Okay, so now I can so how much strict this constant is. Is it very sharp near the edges or the corners, or is it a little bit more spread? That can be determined by the shape of this Dirichlet distribution, by the shape of this Dirichlet distribution. And you know the shape of the Dirichlet distribution can be controlled by this is the Dirichlet distribution. It can be controlled by this parameter. Okay, so this is actually an non-symmetric Dirichlet distribution. You have one different power for different parameters, but I can actually make it symmetric. Let me see if I have an example of a symmetric distribution. Anyway, you can assume all of these to be alphas. So this alpha parameter, one thing you might remember that if alpha is less than 1, then you have this kind of distribution. If alpha is less than 1, you have sparsity distribution. If alpha is greater than 1, we don't prefer sparse. We prefer the uniform distributions. So we will go by alpha less than 1. And the smaller the value of alpha, more sparse it is. So basically, I can change my value of alpha, which is the parameter of the Dirichlet distribution, to control this constant, control the sparsity. So this is, for example, less sparse. All right, so this same process is now repeated for the topic word model also, the same process. I have another Dirichlet distribution with parameter beta, and I have this Dirichlet distribution with parameter alpha, and this beta Dirichlet controls this topic word multinomial matrix. Again, this will come from data, but the constant will be controlled by this. So I have two priors basically. If we look at the expression, this is one prior, Dirichlet beta Dirichlet prior, and this is another prior, we call it the alpha Dirichlet prior, and this is the topic word proportion matrix. This is the topic word proportion matrix, and this is the word topic, sorry, this is the topic document proportion matrix. This is the topic word proportion matrix, and this is the, or maybe the other way around, I have to check. This is the topic word proportion matrix. So these two are multinomials. This is the topic document. And this is the topic word. Those two matrices that I had drawn, two multinomials. Okay, and these are the priors. Let's call it beta prior and alpha prior. Okay, beta prior controls the topic proportion. Beta prior controls the topic proportion, and the alpha prior controls the part topic. Okay, so this is the generative process. If we keep in mind this picture, I think you will understand it. You have to think of the Dirichlet as a priors or constraints, and you have to think of these matrices as the multinomials with a sparsity constraint on them. And this comes from the data. We'll see soon how. Okay, so let us before we start with the training process, let us look at these two matrices. What these matrices tell is that this matrix tells that given a document, you have to basically come up with a set of topics associated with it along with their weights. And what this says, given a topic, you have to say a set of words which constitute the topic along with their weights. So these two values, so we'll look at data iteratively. Okay, so as I've said, one of the reason LDA in practice it works so well is that maybe in practice we follow these two goals, that for each document allocate its words to as few topics as possible, sparsity, and for each topic assign high probability to as few words as possible, again sparsity. And these two goals are actually orthogonal to each other. That means putting a document in a single topic, see the first goal, the best way you can allocate the first goal is to have all document, there is only one topic in the collection, everything belongs to that topic. And moment you do this, the second goal becomes hard because all the words should have should come under the topic, otherwise you are not reflecting the other words. Similarly, if you put only few words in one part topic, sorry, that is if you try to achieve the second goal, then every document will consist of many topics, because every document will contain multiple words and each word is a separate topic, you will have many topics. So these two are at odds. And we try to balance these two to get a good topic allocation to documents and word allocation to topics. Okay, so now let me explain the training process. First, I will explain with an example, then I will give the mathematical expression. But all of you should, even though I have explained it sort of by hand waving, you should remember this plate model. That's the fundamental thing. You should remember this plate model. That's how it is getting generated, and the corresponding expression for the joint distribution. These two you should remember. Okay, let's take this example. I have four documents, doc 1 to doc 4. And let's say as a toy example, each document has five words. So the first document has the words gene, DNA, RNA, mutation, species. Second document has gene, mutation, crossover, fitness, species. So these are the words, five words present per document and four documents. One thing in LDA is that you have to choose the number of topics you want. So that's a hyperparameter. You have to choose the number of topics you want. So let me say that there are three topics, topic one, topic two, topic three. I have colored them red, blue, and green. So I have red topic, blue topic, and green topic. Note that even though you may be tempted to give some name for these topics, some words to be associated, but I will refrain from that. So topics usually you will think of as one, two, and three, or maybe colors, red, green, and blue. The physical interpretation of the topic, what does this topic mean, that is beyond LDA. That is by human inspection. That cannot be done by LDA. So I have, these are the three topics and these are the words. Okay, so let me write down these two matrices, these two matrices as kind of this coloring. So topic one consists, let us think like this. So let us look at doc one. So this has these five words. I will color the words according to which topic that words belong to. That means according to which topic the word has non-zero probability of belonging to. I'll color the words. Forget about the these boxes. So take the docs only. So I have colored these three words as belonging to topic one, red topic. So gene is comes from red topic. You can also think of this as, if you look at the generative process, from say T3 generated W3. So W3 has come from T3. So let's say similarly, gene has come from the red topic. DNA has also come from the red topic. RNA has also come from the red topic. Statistics has come from the blue topic. Species has come from the blue topic. And here, gene has come from the red topic. Note that a word in over multiple documents may come from different topics. Even within the same document, they may come from different topics. Depends on the generative process. Which topic was generated and from that topic, which word was generated. So gene is red, mutation comes from blue, crossover comes from blue, DNA comes from red again, species comes from blue. Similarly here. So one thing to be noted is that, see, doc one is now only two topics, red and blue. Doc two is also two topics, red and blue. Doc three is three topics. And doc four is only one topic. And also by counting this number of words from a particular topic, you can see which topic is dominant. So here the red topic is 3:2 dominant. Here the blue topic is 3:2 dominant. Here there is no dominance. Here the green topic is totally dominant. Okay, so the topic vectors, if we topic proportion vectors, here it is red 3, blue 2, green 0. Here it is red 2, blue 3, green 0. Here it is red 2, blue 2, green 1. Here it is 0, 0, 1. So that's the topic proportional vectors that these docs, that these colors represent. Now, let us also look at, so what I want, this is kind of a good allocation, except for this doc 3, this is kind of a sparse allocation of topics. This is kind of a sparse allocation of topics. Now, let us pick up the words from this. Let us look at so each box corresponds to a word. Each box corresponds to a word. Let us look at the word gene. This is the gene box. If we look at the color of gene over all the documents across the corpus, you see twice the word gene was generated by the red topic. Once it was generated by the green topic. The DNA word was always generated by the red topic. The word statistics was once generated by the blue topic and twice by the green topic. Okay, so these values, this 2:1, 2:1, or 3:0, or 1:2, this kind of represents these columns of this document. Okay, so this means that maybe eight out of something times, word 3 will come from topic 1, 7 out of something times it will come from topic 2, 8 out of something times it will come out of topic 3, and so on. Okay, so this represent this columns of this thing. So basically, if we put this column side by side, you will get this matrix. And similarly, if we put these rows one after the other, you will get the first matrix. Okay, so what I mean to say is that if I can somehow label the documents, the words in the document by the topic they came from, by the color they came from, then maybe from this single, so this is an allocation, this is a topic allocation towards. So just this information is enough. If I have just this data, I can, from this, I can construct this, and using these two information, I can construct both these two matrices. So all I need to construct both these two matrices are this coloring information of doc 1 to doc 4. That's all I need. If I have this, I can generate that matrix. Okay, so in a sense, I am doing a training in the, so what training means? Training means that given a corpus with this kind of labels, a label data, I want to generate those two multinomial matrices, the values of those two multinomial matrices. Okay, and then I'll modulate them using the prior, which I will, the prior, the alpha and beta values that I'll not get from data, that I will assume. Okay, so here is a training algorithm. But now the question is, who will give you this coloring? Once I've got that coloring, my training is over. My training is done. I get these two matrices. But how do I get these colorings? Let me describe an approach based on an approximate inferencing technique known as the Gibbs, which I have already studied. So the process is like this. Start with an initial random assignment of topics to what? So initially, give some random color to these words. Then rearrange the colors. Now one at a time, one word at a time. So initially give some random colors. Now looking at one word at a time, you change the color. Looking at just one word at a time, you change the color with the following two goals, following two sparsity goals. The sparsity goals is that every individual document should be as monochromatic as possible. Okay, that I have already said. So this is completely monochromatic. This is ideal. This is more or less monochromatic. This is not monochromatic. So that's goal one. You start with a random coloring. Now look at the first word, look at the second word, look at the third word. For the first word, flip its color so that this particular document becomes as monochromatic as possible. And not only that, if you do that, everything will be of the same color. Not only that, you keep the second thing in mind. The second thing in mind is that this, what topic coloring that we made, that means you take all the words in the corpus and look at their colors, this should also be as monochromatic as possible. For example, this is completely monochromatic. This is not fully monochromatic. This is also not fully monochromatic. So you should change the color of the ith word, one word at a time, such that that corresponding document becomes more monochromatic. And the word box for that color also becomes more monochromatic. Once I have put this kind of boxes, you can also think of the multinomial not as a k-faced die, but as a box containing colored balls that we have discussed earlier. So that this is more close to that. You can think of these words as balls. And here also they can think of balls and with different colors. Okay, so that's my goal. I want them to be as monochromatic. So this, you know, is a Gibbs sampling. It's a greedy approach. You change one at a time. So in Gibbs sampling, what we do, we update one parameter, keeping all other parameter values constant, and then update the parameter so that the likelihood is maximized, is increased. So I will explain this Gibbs sampling. Let me explain this Gibbs sampling process here. So this is basically Gibbs sampling. This is one way of training the LDA. There are other ways also. There are other ways of training an LDA also. Let me explain. So as I have said, in Gibbs sampling, you keep color of all the other words the same, maybe the same as the initial random assignment. And try to change the color of a single word, of the single word. Try to change the color. This is black, not colored yet. Keeping everything else colors as constant, I want to assign some color to it. Okay. So that the earlier goal that each of these top boxes are as monochromatic and each of these bottom boxes are as monochromatic. So what is your guess? What should be the color so that it stays monochromatic? So this says that, well, this can be red or blue. That will make, it cannot be green. Green will not make it more monochromatic. It is either red or blue. And similarly here, it says it should be either red or green. Blue will not make it more monochromatic. Okay, it should be either red or green. Okay, these two are my options. So let's see, how do we decide? Okay, so what I do is that I forget about, I am trying to assign this gene, color to this word gene, to doc 1. I forget about doc 2, doc 3, doc 4 initially. And similarly, I forget about other words, DNA, statistics, I forget about this word. I look at this box and this box. And gene I have to color. Okay, so I look at doc 1. So without this gene, without a color for gene, what are the count of the topics? So topic 1, red, is 2. Topic 2 is 2. Topic 3 is 0. Okay. Okay, let me take a break. I'll just have a glass of water and come. Give me just 2 minutes. I'll come back.